Good evening. Welcome to this service on this Maundy, Thursday night. There are a few instructions in the beginning of your bulletin, which I just bring your attention to. Tonight we're going to gather essentially around the table and gather with Jesus and the disciples and what happened that night and when they had their last supper together, the Passover meal. So we will be hearing the story and singing a hymn. Hearing the story, singing a hymn. We will take communion together. And when you do, all of you, I hope, have the black ribbon that was supposed to be in your bulletin, but they've been slipping out. There's more in the back if you need one. And as we come down to take communion, we're going to place this ribbon that represents our own sin, our own failings, whatever it is that's heavy burden on you tonight. And we're going to come and either put it on the cross or tie it on the cross, and then we'll be taking communion through intinction. There'll be a couple standing here and over here, and you go and you take some bread, dip it in, and take communion tonight, and then head back to your seat. So that's what this is for, and then I'll have a short meditation a little bit later in the service. So let us join together now in our call to worship.
Would you please stand for our call to worship? After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come.
Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him.
And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." You may be seated. Let us pray. O Father, we gather tonight to remember and to worship you, for you sent your only Son that we might receive eternal life through him. Glory to you, O God. May we live into that eternal life tonight as we worship and glorify you in and through Jesus and the Holy Spirit. May we love you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, more and more, growing ever closer in this, the family of God. Amen. going to be reading from Luke 22, verses 1 through 13, and then we will stand and sing our first hymn. Now the festival of unleavened bread, which was called the Passover, was near. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to put Jesus to death, for they were afraid of the people. Then Satan entered into Judas, called Iscariot, who was one of the 12. He went away and conferred with the chief priests and officers of the temple police about how he might betray him to them. They were greatly pleased and agreed to give him money. So he consented and began to look for an opportunity to betray him to them when no crowd was present. Then came the day of unleavened bread, which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover meal for us, that we may eat it." They asked him, "Where do you want us to make preparations for it?" "Listen," he said to them, "when you have entered a city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house he enters, and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks you, where is the guest room? Where may I eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you to a large room upstairs, already furnished. Make preparations for us there." So they went and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. Please stand for our hymn number 518, Your Only Son.
The next scripture reading is from Luke 22, verses 14 to 23. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to that man who betrays me." They began to question among themselves which of them it might be who would do this. And if you'll turn to page 215, we'll sing "What Wondrous Love Is This."
Tonight, as we gather around this table, everyone, anyone, all that trust in Jesus are invited to take part in this meal. In this Passover meal, which the disciples and Jesus celebrated that night, they remembered how God spared the Israelites and defeated the Egyptians so they could escape from slavery. Jesus said he was eager to celebrate this meal, for he realized that they were in the midst of a new Passover. A Passover soon to take place where he would be the lamb sacrificed. For this day, the day they celebrated, was the day of the unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed. Tonight, let us all eagerly come to this table as well. Jesus invites each of us to receive himself, the Lamb of God, whose blood covers us, who created a way where there was no way for us to be welcomed into God's family, to share the life given to us in Jesus eternally. Tonight we'll take part in the very ancient practice of intinction. That's what Jesus celebrated with his disciples at the table. They took the bread and they dipped it in the cup and then they ate. And we're going to do the same thing tonight. So when you come forward, don't forget to bring your ribbon to hang. And then go to whichever station works best for you to go back and go to your station and go back. And if you can't come down tonight, just raise your hand and one of our teams will come and serve you. Let's pray together. Holy God, our Father, what a mystery this meal is. How Jesus came to be the Lamb who would take away the sin of the world. Thank you, Father, for sending your Son to become our Savior, to be the sacrifice that would allow all peoples to finally be your people because of the cross. Thank you for Jesus' blood that covers our sin. We recognize that at this table with Jesus, there are those who fled that night when he was gathered with his disciples. There were those who denied him. There were those who betrayed him. Yet he still offered them the bread and the cup. He still offered them his life in that meal. So we pause now in our prayer. We pause in our time to silently confess to you our own denials, our own betrayals, the times that we fled, the times we found ourselves in darkness and separation, the times which these ribbons symbolize. Lord, we offer these ribbons in a few moments, that in our minds, in our hearts, that as we hang those, we realize that Jesus' blood covers all of our burdens tonight, any worries that we're carrying, any regrets, any sin that's left that we haven't maybe brought to you before, that tonight we leave it on this cross, giving it to you. And knowing that you have washed us clean because of your great love and forgiveness. We rejoice in you, Jesus, and give thanks to you for this bread and this cup. For it is life you've promised us. It is life in you, Jesus, that makes us alive. We rejoice and that you want to recreate us each time we take this meal together. And we rejoice, Creator God, that you take notice of us, that you come close to us tonight in this place, in and through Jesus and the Holy Spirit. So we celebrate the wonder of how you love us and ask that you help us to love each other as that we are so loved by your Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray. And as we pray tonight, we want to pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On that Passover night, Jesus took the bread. And after he'd given thanks as we have, he said, This is my body, which is given to you. Take this and share it among yourselves as you remember me. And then he picked up a cup and said, Thanks, as we said before, and then said, This cup is poured out for you. It is a new covenant in my blood. For as you eat this bread and as you drink this cup, you show forth my death until I come again in glory. Let us share in this feast together with Jesus. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for giving us yourself as food to bring wholeness to us, to bring forgiveness in our souls, to bring light where there's darkness, to lift burdens that are heavy, to bring healing grace and mercy. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for you are life, and you give us yourself as life eternal. We are so grateful and thankful. Amen.
I'm going to continue reading in Luke 22, starting with verse 24. A dispute also arose among them as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But he said to them, "The king of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? But I am among you as the one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you, just as my Father has conferred on me, a kingdom, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on the thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel." Please stand for our next hymn, number 218, verses 1 and 2.
The next scripture reading is from Luke, chapter 22, verses 35 to 38. Then Jesus asked them, "When I sent you without a purse, bag, or sandals, did you lack anything?" "Nothing," they answered. He said to them, "But now if you have a purse, take it, and also a bag. And if you don't have a sword, sell your cloak and buy one. It is written, 'And he was numbered with the transgressors.' And I tell you that this must be fulfilled in me. Yes, what is written about me is reaching its fulfillment." The disciple said, "See, Lord, here are two swords." "That's enough," he replied. And we will stay seated to sing the next hymn, 220, and verses 1 to 3.
last scripture reading for tonight is, we are still in Luke 22. It's verses 39 through 53. He came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down, and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial." While he was still speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, "Judas, is it with a kiss that you betray the Son of Man?" And when those who were around him saw what was coming, they asked, "Lord, should we strike with the sword?" And then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, "No more of this." And he touched his ear and healed him. And then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who had come for him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness." Gethsemane. This word is from the Aramaic, and it means oil press. Luke did not write the actual name Gethsemane. You haven't heard it tonight. Instead, he wrote the place. But the other Gospels agree that Jesus was on the Mount of Olives when he was betrayed and arrested. And that place was Gethsemane, where he went to pray. In the 8 verses, Luke 39 to 46, Jesus gave his disciples a very strong invitation to pray. He begins and ends with the imperative command, pray. It was more than an invitation. Pray that you do not come into time of trial. But when they had the opportunity to pray, they did not. They slept. I wonder, how many times has that been us? How many times we had the opportunity to pray, but we were either too busy, too sleepy, too upset, or too, I know you're mentally putting in your own word in there, whatever it is that kept us from prayer. Here's the tricky part about praying. We need to be praying, as Jesus is trying to help them understand, before we get to our own Gethsemane spot, where we're going to be pressed, squeezed, feel like someone's coming down hard on us. Before we find we are tempted, before something awful happens, before the tragedy occurs, before we get the difficult diagnosis, before the phone rings, with whatever is coming on that time of day when you don't get phone calls. I suppose you may be thinking, "Now, Pastor Karen, I think that's rather difficult. How do we know when these terrible situations are about to occur? How can we plan our prayer time around them?" We can't. That's why praying frequently and consistently is all the more important. We have a lot to do each day. Don't you have a long to-do list? I know I do. But we can't be ready for what isn't on our to-do list unless we begin with prayer. We can't be ready for the unexpected, the uninvited, the unknown, unless we're praying. We may become so distracted, so distraught, so anxious that we can't hear that still small voice of God unless we stop, read some scripture, listen, and pray. Jesus prays a prayer that may seem, if we are honest, rather useless to us. "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." Or as N.T. Wright's translation, Father, if you wish, please take this cup away from me, but it must be your will, not mine. He not only prayed this once, but depending on the gospel you read, he prayed it three times, as many as maybe more. Why? Why did he pray it so many times? Jesus was checking. He was double checking. He was triple checking that there was no other way, no other Lamb of God that was going to be in the bush, no other plan that he had missed, checking that indeed what he'd heard was correct. This was a very humble prayer. It was a very loving prayer. It was a deeply troubled and moving prayer. For Jesus was facing a sort of persecution. It was very dark. It was awful. But it was more than that. It was a persecution foretold in Scripture. He was the Lamb of God that was slain, just as in the Passover story that they just acted out through the meal they'd had together. His is the blood now that's going to be painted on the doorways to keep the Israelites safe from the plague of death. Jesus was now the condemned Lamb of God, so his blood could cover all of us too, all who call on his name. And in the moments of ahead of this, he prayed. He urged his followers to do the same, but they couldn't understand him. They didn't realize he was about to take the curse so that we wouldn't be under it anymore. He didn't need those swords. He needed their prayers. Thankfully, Jesus had prayed for Peter. He told him so. So that although when he went through his time of trial, his faith would not fail completely, and he would be able to strengthen his brothers when he came back. Peter, however, was confident, cocky. He wasn't going to betray Jesus. No way. He could not understand that the story of the Passover they just experienced in that meal was what he was now experiencing with Jesus. Jesus encouraged Peter to pray that he would not come into a time of trial. And we pray it every week, don't we, in our Lord's Prayer. The one from the King James Version, the one that we just probably said out loud when we prayed, was, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Or maybe you remember how it is in Luke, the New Revised Standard, and do not bring us into the time of trial. Or maybe you like the New Living Translation, don't let us yield to temptation. Whichever one, in all those words, we are actually saying we are too weak. We're too weak in our own human beings. The resources we have aren't enough. Jesus is quite clear. These trials and temptations are beyond us, and we will fail if we don't have God's help. In our prayers, we gain the faith that reminds us that Jesus intercedes as he did for Peter. Jesus will sustain us too, just as he promised. However, if we are oblivious or unwilling to ask for help, we may find we have denied him three times before the cock crows, and that's pretty early in the morning. So tomorrow morning, before the cock crows, you are invited, if you'd like to take part, in a prayer vigil for Good Friday. There's a little sign-up sheet on that table out there, and there's some papers that have prayers. They look something like this, that are out there if you'd like. Because maybe that's a good way to start our Good Friday. If you're really anxious, I invite you to start tonight. Good Friday starts at midnight, so I'm willing for you to start then too. But what do we need to pray for? Maybe you're wondering. What trial is coming our way? What is there that we need to be sustained through? I don't know, but God does. God knows. Jesus invites us to pray and be blessed by reading and hearing his love and promises. To sit in his presence and realize we sit in the presence of God our Father. to come and drink from the well that never runs dry, for he's our living water, to never go hungry because he's the bread of life, to never be lonely because he's our friend, and to never worry because he's our Savior. When life seems wonderful and we have no troubles, God bless you. And then come and tell him your good news, your joys, and your contentment. Maybe you feel you don't know how to pray. Scripture says when we pray, if we don't have the words, the Holy Spirit will help us. And all we have to do is groan or sigh. And the Spirit gives words to those prayers too. Jesus couldn't make his friends pray. He couldn't hold their heads up. And he can't do that for us either. But if we would spend even 1 hour, okay, even a half hour out of 24 in prayer, his promises for us are very real. In Chronicles, it reads, "If my people who are called by my name humble themselves, pray and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land." Well, maybe you don't need your land healed, but maybe you have a friend or a relative or yourself that needs healing. Jesus told us to pray for our enemies. We need his help for that one. Jesus told us to pray and keep praying, like the widow who went to the unjust judge and wouldn't give up. I'm guessing we need his help for that one too. Sometimes I've had people tell me that they don't feel like they should trouble the Lord with their problems. Do you know anyone like that? But Jesus showed us that in prayer, that prayer was essential to his life because he prayed. So I guess if Jesus prayed, maybe we should too. Even our troubles, God wants to hear. And beyond our own problems, our prayers extend out past ourselves for our neighbors and our friends. And lest we forget, we need to pray for each other, the church. We must pray for all that our session and our boards of elders and deacons in all our churches is for nothing if we're not praying. And we must pray or our vision statements and our plans that we've made aren't worth anything. We must pray, or this light that this and all our congregations shine in the darkness, they may go out. Truly, this dark world needs the light of the world, even more today than ever before. Let's pray. Holy and wonderful God, on this night when Jesus went out to pray before he went to the cross, thank you for the reminder that we need to pray, that we need to set aside some time, more than just on Maundy, Thursday, to come before you and listen and hear what you want to say to us, and to offer all that's on our hearts to you, to offer all that troubles us and give it to you, and then to receive your goodness, to receive your words of forgiveness, your words of comfort, your words of blessing, your words of hope, your words that are just for us, and then to hear what you want us to do, where you want us to go, who you need for us to love. Lord, we come tonight as the people of God, and we know that there's much in our world that needs your care and your love. There's many places, Lord, where there's fighting tonight. There's many places where people don't have enough to eat tonight. There's many places where governments are reeling in corruption and chaos, where they need you tonight. There are places closer to home where people live in this country, but they don't feel like they're free. Some feel like they're enslaved in the poverty that they don't know how to break out of. Some are feeling that they have no hope because of their family situation, because of their don't have work. Many reasons. Lord, we lift them to you. Lord, there are people in our own community that are overwhelmed by addiction, overwhelmed by many types of addiction, Lord, and they need your help. Lord, there are families in our community who are struggling, families in the hospital, families grieving, families alone. And Lord, we lift up our churches. Churches are struggling too, Lord. We don't know how to reach out to our neighbors. We aren't sure if they want us to reach out. We don't always know which way to turn. But we know that you have light and you have work for your church today. For all the things we've just talked about in the world, you are needed. So Lord, in all these ways, we ask that you would show us. We believe that you're at work in them and that you call us alongside. So Lord, we lift up the concerns of our hearts. And we believe you have more than we can see. We believe you have healing. We believe you have comfort. We believe you have joy. We believe you have goodness that is never ending and mercy that is full of forgiveness and grace when we need it most. We believe that you love with a steadfast love that never stops. Not even the grave can stop that love. So we wrap these prayers up in that love. And we thank you for taking them and for showing us how we can be your hands and feet this night. And reminding us to be in prayer as we move through Good Friday and Holy Saturday. And thank you, God, for Sunday, Resurrection Day. In your name, Lord Jesus, we do pray. Amen. Our final hymn is number 223, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. And after our hymn, I invite you to quietly leave tonight in a time of beginning our meditation and beginning our prayer time and thinking about what it is tomorrow brings. So let us stand now as we sing our closing hymn.